Before we take up the central problem in this chapter of classification of G coverings, I would like to present a method of obtaining new G coverings out of the old one. This time, changing the base itself. Since this method involves a new concept, which is important on its own, not only in algebraic topology but elsewhere also. So let us study this one a little more carefully and in a little more generality, not full generality. Start with the base space B and take two functions fi from ei to B. Their fibral product is defined to be a triple, a topological space, and two functions pi I. Pi I is from Z to ei, I equal to 1 and 2. With the condition that f1 pi 1 is equal to f2 pi 2. So the composite map from Z to E1 to B or Z to E2 to B, they are the same. And this entire thing satisfying the so-called universal property. So this is the picture. Z is here, E1, E2 are here, B is here, okay? So F1 and F2 are functions into B. Okay. Then Z is a function from pi 1, has a function pi 1 and pi 2 respectively to E1 and E2. If you have another commutative diagram like this, Z prime, pi 1 prime, pi 2 prime, respectively maps from E1 to E2, such that when you compose with F2 here and F1 there, they are the same. F1, pi 1 prime, okay, F2, pi 2 prime, they are the same. Then this Z prime will have a map into Z, fitting this dotted arrow. Okay, this is the conclusion of the definition. There exists a map G, unique map G, such that the whole diagram is commutative, namely pi 1 G equal to pi 1 prime and pi 2 G equal to pi 2 prime. For every Z prime and pairs of maps which satisfy this property, there must be a unique map like this. So this is the universal property of this commutative square here. Okay, then this Z together with these two maps is called the fiber product of F1 and F2. Okay, so this is the definition of the fiber product of two functions taking values in the same space P. The uniqueness of such a pair, Z E1, Z pi 1 and Z pi 2, like this, up to homeomorphism, follows easily by this universal property. Namely, suppose Z prime is another such pair which also has a universal property, then it will admit a map from Z to Z prime in the reverse direction here, such that again the same diagram, all these diagrams are commutative. Then what you have is G prime, let us say, G prime going Z to Z prime, coming back by G, that will be another map from Z to Z itself, fitting this diagram. Identity map fits this diagram from Z to Z. Therefore, there will be two of them. By the uniqueness property of this map, that composite G followed by G prime must be identity of Z. That means That means what? By the same argument, that this G prime is a inverse of G, that G is a homeomorphism. So this is typical of all universal properties, definition given by universal properties. Existence of such objects is not guaranteed, but uniqueness is guaranteed. Okay? So let us look at the existence. The existence here is very easy compared to many such existence theorems. So for the existence, what I do is I define Z to be a subspace of E1 cross E2 consisting of pairs E1 E2 such that under F1, F1 of E1 is F2 of E2. Take the product and take this subspace. On this subspace, there is already projection maps given by this product. Product E1 E2 has projection maps pi1, pi2 respectively to E1 E2. Just take the restriction of that on Z. So these are now, I am denoting them by pi I, but now I am thinking them as maps from Z to EI. Obviously, if you project E1, E2, you get E1, then F1 of E1 is same thing as F1, pi1 of E1, E2, okay? It's F2 of E2 is same thing as F2 of pi2 of E2. So the commutativity of this diagram is obvious. You have got a commutative diagram like this, all right? That we have constructed Z. But now I have to show that this Z has universal property, right? That's also easy. For if Z prime, F1 prime, F2 prime is another triple with the same property, then we just define G of Z prime. I'm taking G of Z prime here to be pi 1 prime of G, pi 1 prime of Z prime, comma, pi 2 prime of Z prime as an element of E1 cross E2. But when you go here, they agree. That is why by the very definition of Z, that pair pi 1 prime Z prime, comma, pi 2 prime Z prime is inside Z. So that gives you a map into Z. Okay, so that's what I am doing here. F1 prime Z1 and F2 prime Z2. Okay? This is not this in this definition, in this notation, I have put pi1 prime here. So I should take pi1 prime, pi2 prime. Okay? Not F1 prime, F2 prime. Okay? So that G fits the diagram. This is the only way a map can fit there, because any map into a product, first of all, is determined by the two projection maps, pi2 and pi1. So two coordinates you have to define. So therefore, if there is a map, it has to be this map. Okay, the first projection, first coordinate has to be this one, this map. The second coordinate has to be this map. And that defines that defines an element of Z, because Z is taken as those points wherein when you go to F1, they agree. Under F1 and F2, they agree. Okay. So that is the construction, and the construction and uniqueness are over. All right. So this is a very simple-minded thing to begin with, but it has wonderful properties. The fiber product, by very definition, is symmetric in F1, F2. Okay, you can say, you can write it as F1 cross F2 or F2 cross F1. So I just omit having a notation for this one. Okay, it has some wonderful properties, namely, if F1 is surjective, then I will use this diagram. If F1 is surjective, then π2 will be surjective. If F1 is injective, then π2 is injective. If F1 is a homeomorphism, then π2 is a homeomorphism. If F1 is a covering projection, π2 is a covering projection. If F1 is a G covering, π2 will be G covering. So many topological properties of F1 will be reflected here. Of course, there are some which don't. So for example, if F1 is a co-fibration, then this will be a fibration. If F1 is a co-fibration, there is no guarantee that this will be a co-fibration. The co-fibration will happen if you reverse all these arrows and then take the co-fibrate product. Then it says something like co. Okay, dual to all this, when arrows are all reversed. Okay, so co-fibration won't fit here. Fibration is vibration, this will be a alpha vibration. So let us verify a few of them, which I am going to use them also. Meanwhile, we will get familiar with this definition and the construction also. Okay? Let us verify surjectivity. F1 is surjective, I'm assuming. I want to show that π2 is surjective. What do I do? Take a point in E2, okay? Pick up a point in E1, which sits over F2 of E2. F2 of E2 is an element of B. F1 is surjective, therefore F1 of E1 will be equal to that point, such as E1 will be there, okay? Now, by the very construction, E1 comma E2 is an element of Z. And the second projection of this, π2, is E2. So starting with any E2, I have produced an element in Z such that π2 of that element is E2. So π2 is surjective. All right. Let us verify the injectivity, which is slightly little lengthier, one line lengthier. Suppose F is injective, F1. I want to show that π2 is injective. So pick up two points in Z. How do they look like? E1, E2, E1 prime, E2 prime. Okay. Suppose π2 of them are equal. What is the meaning of that? The second coordinate E2 must be equal to E2 prime. Okay. Then I have to show that E1 equal to E1 prime. If the second coordinates are equal, I have to show that E1 is equal to E2 prime. Then that will complete that π2 is injective, right? But what is the meaning of these points are inside Z? They are not arbitrary elements of E1 cross E2. This means that F1 of E1 is F2 of E2. F1 of E1 prime is F2 of E2 prime. Therefore, if you start with F1 of E1, which is F2 of E2, but E2 is E2 prime, so it's F2 of E2 prime, but F2 of E2 prime is F1 of E1 prime. But F1 is injective is our assumption. Therefore, E1 must be equal to E1 prime. So we are done. Okay, in particular, if F1 is a bijection, then π2 will be a bijection. Okay, so let us go a little further. Suppose F1 is a local homeomorphism, then I have to show that π2 is a local homeomorphism. Okay, so start with a point in Z, I must produce an open subset of Z restrict for this, π2 restricted to that, must be a homeomorphism onto its image in B. In E2. Okay, I have to find such a neighborhood. First of all, I should use that F1 is a local homeomorphism. So I look at E1. E1 has a neighborhood U1 in E1 such that F1 restricted to u1 to f1 of u1, let us call it as v, this is a homeomorphism. So that is the definition of local homeomorphism. And v is an open subset of b. Then put u2 equal to f inverse of this v, f2 inverse of this v. So that will be open in e2. Now I have got two open subsets, one u1, another u2, right? U1 open in e1, u2 open in e2. Therefore, u1 cross u2 will be open inside e1 cross e2, the product space. Intersection with z, that will be an open subset of z. And it contains the point e1, e2. Why? Because if you look at f1 of e1, that will be a point of u1, this v, f1 of, sorry, that's the point of f1 of u1, that's v. Therefore, every point here is f2 of that is inside v. So I have taken a point. Where I have taken a point? I have taken a point in u1 cross u2, intersect with z. That means if I take a pair here, what is the property of that? F1 of a point here is equal to F2 of a point there. Okay. So E1, E2 belongs to that. So this is an open subset. So E1, E2 is a has a neighborhood that much we have formed out inside that. Claim is this W has this required property, namely pi 2 from W to U2 below, U2 is this one, is a local homeomorphism. Okay. Now, first thing is the bijectivity of this from W to U2 follows from the bijectivity of this F1 exactly as in the previous two steps. Okay. F1 was assumed to be bijective on the whole space U there. Whole space E1. So restrict to the whole thing instead of E1 and E2 to U1 and this U2. Instead U1 cross U2, you have the same construction that is those points which are F1 of U1 equal to F2 of U2. That's why the step 1 and step 2 are valid here also. Okay. So bijectivity of pi 2 follows by bijectivity of F1. All right. Now we have to show that it is a homeomorphism. Inverse is continuous is what you have to show. So look at S, which is the inverse for this F1. This is a homeomorphism. From V to U1, there is an inverse of F1, which is continuous. That is the meaning that is a homeomorphism. Using that, define an inverse U2 to W by the formula H of E2 prime equal to S composite F2 comma E2 prime. Second coordinate is E2 prime. Automatically, when you apply pi 2 to this one, you will get E2. So this H will be inverse of pi 2. Why it is continuous? Because this is second coordinate is just identity here. The first coordinate I S composite F2 which is continuous. Therefore, this is a continuous inverse. Okay. A homeomorphism, the inverse of F will produce an inverse here. All right. So it's a local homeomorphism. Actually, this also proves that if F itself is a homeomorphism, then pi 2 would be a homeomorphism. Okay. So that proof is also here. In more generally, local homeomorphism implies local homeomorphism is what we have seen now. The next thing is, if F1 is a covering projection, then so is pi 2. In fact, we claim that you take an evenly covered open subset of B, evenly covered by F1. टेक इट्स इनवर्स इमेज बाय एफ टू इन साइड ई टू. ओके, क्लेम इज दैट ओपन सेट इज इवनली कवर्ड बाय पाई टू. सो वी इज कंटेंड इन साइड बी ओपन सेट विच इज इवनली कवर्ड बाय एफ वन. द क्लेम इज डब्ल्यू विच इज एफ टू इनवर्स ऑफ वी इज इवनली कवर्ड बाय पाई टू. Suppose I prove this one by the very definition of covering projection. You have an open covering of B consisting of evenly covered neighborhoods, evenly covered open subsets. Inverse image of those things will be an open cover for E2. Each of them I am going to prove that they are evenly covered here. So pi 2 will be a covering projection. So it's enough to prove this statement, okay? Namely, W is evenly covered. That means I have to look for pi 2 inverse of W, write it as a disjoint union of open sets such that restricted to any one of them, pi 2 is a homeomorphism. What is my source? Source is similar statement for F1. Namely, write U, write V, this must be V, this is all typos. Write V, F1 inverse of V as disjoint union of U alphas. U alphas are open in E1. Restricted to each U alpha, F1 is a homeomorphism. Let us put S alpha to be the inverse of that. That will depend upon alpha, right? So V2 U alpha, S alpha is the inverse of F1. All right? Then pi 2 inverse of W. Remember, this is same thing as what is W? W is F1 inverse of V. Here it is correct. Instead of from V to U ho gaya either, this must be V. Pi 1 inverse of F1 inverse of V. Okay. Because this is W is F2 inverse of V. F2 inverse, pi 2 inverse F2 inverse is in the pi inverse F1 inverse. It's pi inverse F1 inverse, but F1 inverse is disjoint union of U alpha. Therefore, this is a disjoint union of pi 1 inverse of U alpha. Pi 1 being continuous, these are open subsets of E1 cross E2. But I am restricting it to Z, intersection with Z I am taking. So they are open subsets. Disjointness is still there because they are disjoint, inverse images of disjoint open subsets here. Okay, pi 1 inverse of alpha, U alpha is disjoint. So I've got a disjoint family, okay? I want to show that each one of them projects homeomorphically onto this W under pi 2. This part already follows what we have seen in the local homeomorphism picture. What is the inverse, corresponding inverse? Use this S alpha to get the corresponding inverse, just the way I have done it here. So H alpha here will be defined as S alpha composite F2, comma identity. Okay. So that is what you have to do here. Okay. So just like what we have seen in the previous paragraph, it follows that pi 2 from pi 1 inverse of U alpha W is a homeomorphism. It is inverse given by H alpha of V2 equal to S alpha composite F2 of E2, comma E2. Now we come to one of the most interesting part now. Namely, if F1 is a G covering, then pi 2 is a G covering. Okay. If it's a covering, this is a covering, it's already done. So only thing is now, we have to see that they are given by actually an even action of the group G. Okay. Suppose G acts on evenly, and the corresponding projection map from E1 to B is the resulting quotient map, which is a covering obviously. So F1, I am thinking of this as a quotient map now by the action of G. We claim that there is an even action of G on Z such that this pi2 becomes the corresponding quotient map. You can't change pi2, by the way. Okay. In Z, the pi2, pi1, etc. are already defined. Okay. Once E1 and E2, F1 and F2 are given, Z is defined. But I want to claim that this itself becomes a quotient map corresponding to the action of G, and therefore it's a covering projection. Not only that, okay, the pi1 from Z to E1, there are G actions on both sides. This pi1 becomes a G map. Indeed, this extra thing will tell you what you have to do. Okay. So this is more or less like last part is more or less like a hint here for the construction of Z. So we define the action of Z on Z, obvious action. There is an action of G on E1, and we don't know anything about E2. E2 is just an arbitrary topological space. Therefore, take the action of this G on E1 cross E2 via the first factor. G of E1 E2 is G E1 E2. Now suppose E1 E2 is already inside Z. Then when you act by this, namely G E1 E2, this will be also inside Z. Why? Why it is inside Z? I have to verify that F1 of E1 is equal to F2 of E2. This is the property for E1 E2 inside Z. But what is F1 of G E1? Because F1 is a quotient map under G action, F1 of G E1 is F1 of E1. Therefore, F1 of G E1 is also equal to F2 of E2. Okay, so therefore, the right hand side is inside Z if E1 E2 is inside Z. So this action of G on E1 cross E2 actually gives you action on Z. Okay, that's the meaning of that this is well defined. Now, clearly each orbit under G action is mapped to the same point E2. Second part is not changed at all in pi2. Therefore, the fibers of pi2 are orbits. And they are precisely the orbits. Okay, because E1 prime comma E2 is in Z, is any element. Okay, E1 prime must be inside F1 inverse of F2 of E2 by definition that it is inside that. Okay, F1 inverse of something, whatever it is, it is one single fiber, one single G orbit. And hence there must be a G belong to G such that G of E1 must be equal to this element, E1 prime, because it is in the same orbit. That just means that G of E1 E2 is E1 prime E2. Okay, so this shows that the fibers of pi2 under Z, inside Z, they are precisely equal to the orbits of just the action G, which just means that this map is a quotient map. Okay. Well, it doesn't mean that the whole thing is a quotient map. But it's a covering projection already. That we have already seen. right? A covering projection is an open quotient. Therefore, it's open surjective. Therefore, it's a quotient. The fibers are correct, but why it's a quotient map requires some explanation. But we have already seen that it is a covering projection. Okay, there are slightly different ways of seeing that quotient. That doesn't matter. So what we have seen is that pi 2 from Z to E2 is actually corresponds to the covering projection by a G action. Look at the way we have defined this action here. G of E1 E2 is G E1 E2. What happens to when you come to pi 1? Pi 1 of this is pi 1 of G E1. Okay, which is G of just GE1, this pi 1 is sorry, just GE1, which is G of E1. On this side it is E1. So pi 1 of E1 E2 operated by G is the same thing as GE1. So this very definition shows that the projection map to pi 1 is a G action, yeah, G map. Okay. So this was last part here, projection is G-map. So I have taken that as a key, as a clue to define this action, and it works. All right. So these are the basic things that we need to explain our classification of G-coverings. So this is going to produce a large number of G coverings. If you have one G covering and any map into the base space, you can construct the G covering on the other space. So this procedure is precisely called, has a different name, which is non-symmetric in the definition, in the idea. Because the role of F1, you know, properties of F1 are reflected in pi 2. F2 may not have any of these properties, maybe just a continuous function. That is why the role is important, though in the definition of the fibrous product, F1 and F2 doesn't matter, which one doesn't matter. That is the beauty of this. So we introduce a non-symmetric wording here, namely, this is the point. F1 and F2, though the fibrous product is symmetric in that, the role of F1 and F2 are different. Okay. So we shall introduce a terminology which is not symmetric in that sense. Namely, we shall call this map pi 2 from Z to E2 as the pullback of the map F1, E1 to be via F2, and denote it by F2 star of F1. This is a categorical notation, it does not depend on the construction. Here we have heavily used the construction, but all these things can be done in a categorical language without appealing to the construction. Okay, that will be taking you a little more deeper. We don't have any time for that. Okay, here we use the easy set theory, which gives you all these answers easily. So this map will be called the pullback. The corresponding covering projection will be called pullback covering projection. So if you start with a G covering, E to B, I am going to use a different notation now. E to B is a G covering. There is a map, okay? There is a map F from B prime to B, then I get a G covering on B prime, which I am going to write as F star of P. P is a G covering, F star of P is a G covering. What we have seen is, if P is surjective, injective, local homeomorphism, covering projection, G covering, etc., the same is true for F star of P. Okay? थैंक यू।